Hi, now it's time for part two, where we're talking about where do you locate evidence-based practices. By the end of this part, I would hope that you will learn several methods for locating evidence-based practices. And remember, when I'm talking about evidence-based practices, that might be evidence-based interventions or evidence-based strategies. And I also want you to understand what constitutes evidence. I talked a little bit about this in the previous part, but we're going to do more with this in this part. So where are we? Here we are with our DBI framework, and we're still focusing on this part up here. And remember, I like that it says validated intervention program, but I really want you to think about this is your instructional platform. This is your jumping off point for the DBI framework. So when we talked about our umbrella terms of evidence-based practice, we have our evidence-based interventions and our evidence-based strategies. And when we want to, we can rely on promising practices. In this part, we're going to say, well, where do I find these, Sarah? All right. So there's two sources that I want you to think about. We can use journals or books. We can read those to find the research. But another good source is the internet. And so I'm going to go over some very helpful websites that you should definitely know about. Now, a source that you might have, but I really don't want you to use, is talk from other people. So if the teacher down the hall, or if you go to a conference and they say like, oh, this is really great, you should try that, you should always ask for the evidence. So I really want you to rely more on sources like journals and books or the internet. These are places that actually have had like a peer review. Other people do say that these are helpful and promising practices. Try not to rely on just the talk of others. Now, when I'm thinking about journals or books, you might say, well, Sarah, I don't really want to read all these things. And I kind of agree with you. I don't always love reading journals from cover to cover. But there are a few that I think usually have some pretty good research, especially related to kids that have mathematics learning difficulties. Now, this is my list. So other people might say this and say, oh, you forgot this journal or you forgot this book. That is probably true. But these are some of the ones that I usually go to figure out what's kind of the new research coming out about kids with math learning difficulties and intensive intervention. So you might want to try Exceptional Children or Intervention in School and Clinic. This is a pretty easy to read journal. The Journal of Ed Psych is always nice. So is the Journal of Learning Disabilities, Learning and Individual Differences, Learning Disability Quarterly, and Learning Disabilities Research and Practice, and Teaching Exceptional Children. This is also a pretty easy read. And I would say in any of these journals, usually in any issue, there's at least one article about intervention or assessment of students with mathematics learning difficulties. Now, you can look at journals or books, but probably you'd say, oh, Sarah, it's much easier for me to sit in bed and use my laptop. Well, that's probably true. So here are some websites where we can locate evidence. Now, I'm going to go through these quickly, but in your activity that follows this section right here, you're going to look at each of these websites. So if I'm going too fast, don't worry. You'll have an opportunity to explore them on your own. So the What Works Clearinghouse is a good website to start with. So if you go to the main page, and this is what it looks like in July of 2017, I can click on mathematics, and then it says find what works based on the evidence. Oh, look, we were just talking about evidence. Now, the thing about the What Works Clearinghouse, it's a good starting point, but not all of the evidence that they will show you has been specifically tested for students with learning difficulties. So it's a good starting point, but it might not be your ending point. Another good starting point is the evidence for ESSA-site. Here's what it looks like right now in 2017. If you click down here on math programs and then go to elementary or middle and high school, it will show you programs that have an evidence base. Now, the evidence for ESSA website is a little bit linked with the What Works Clearinghouse, so you might see the same things listed. It doesn't mean that they've been tested twice, but they may be kind of doing like a cross categorization of their listings there. Now, those are two general education websites, and I always think they're a good place to start. But there are some sites that are more specific to students that have mathematics learning difficulties, and the first one you might want to check out is the Teaching LD website. So this is run through the Division for Learning Disabilities of the Council for Exceptional Children. And they produce information that's very, very not hands-on, but very easy to read and very helpful for teachers. So you can see that here's a listing of things that you can read about. Not all of them are for mathematics, but quite a few of them are. But they can inform you of new research that's coming out. Another helpful website is the website, the Evidence-Based Intervention Network from the University of Missouri. Here, if I click on over here where it says math interventions, you can click on that, and they have a survey of both evidence-based interventions and evidence-based strategies, and you can see what the research says about those things related to mathematics. But then finally, we're going to land on the National Center for Intensive Intervention, and there is our DBI framework diagram. And if you click here on Tools Charts and you can go to Academic Interventions, it has a list of more evidence-based interventions. I think there are a few evidence-based strategies listed on the site, but it's also a really good place to figure out, well, I don't want to read this journal and I don't really trust the teacher down the hall. Who can I trust to find evidence-based interventions and strategies? You could start here with the National Center on Intensive Intervention. So I said you're going to have some practice with this, so now it's time. So activity number 3 is to locate a Tier 2 evidence-based practice in mathematics for a 4th grade student. So I want you to look at each of these sites and see if you can find a Tier 2 evidence-based practice for a 4th grade student. So you're going to look at each of the sites, and then I want you to compare the sites on how easy was the site to use. How good was the information on the site? And then really just write for yourself, what were the pros and cons of the site? So as you embark on your DBI voyage, so 6 months from now, you might say, oh, how do I find evidence-based interventions and evidence-based strategies? It would probably be helpful for you to look back at this workbook activity and had made notes like, oh, I really liked this website, totally easy to use. This website a little bit bulkier. So that's what I want you to explore with this activity. Okay, so we are talking in this part about evidence-based practices and where to find those evidence-based practices. I have a hair on my face, that's okay. So once you find those evidence-based interventions or those evidence-based strategies, you need to think about the quality of the evidence. Now, in the previous part, I introduced this, but I just want to go over it quickly again. When I have an evidence-based intervention or an evidence-based strategy, I always want to think, like, is there assessment data that shows results? Does it show improvement from before the intervention, or does the data show improvement for students who receive the intervention or strategy compared to students who did not? Has the work been replicated? So did multiple researchers conduct it? Have they worked with multiple students and has it been done multiple times? And then I also want you to think about, is the setting and the students that were involved in the original research similar to your own? So how easily would this transfer to your setting? Now I'm going to talk through each of these. So this is a screenshot from an IES practice guide that's about helping students in elementary and middle school who have math learning disabilities or math learning difficulty. And this practice guide by Russell Gersten and a bunch of other colleagues is easily found on the Institute of Education Sciences website. If you go to your favorite search engine, I won't say any out loud, and you type in IES, that stands for Institute of Education Sciences. If you go to IES Practice Guide Math, this will be one of the 6 that comes up there. But what this practice guide shows us is that what does the collection of research for students with learning difficulties tell us about teaching students with learning difficulties? So they have analyzed assessment data to show results. And the results tell us, and we'll see this in other modules, that there's moderate levels of evidence to provide intervention for students identified at risk. There's low evidence, but still some evidence that says that we need to really focus on whole numbers and rational numbers. But the assessment data tells us there's really strong evidence for using explicit instruction, strong evidence for explicitly teaching problem solving, moderate evidence for using visual representations, moderate evidence for helping students build fluency, and then low evidence for monitoring progress and using motivational strategies. Now, even I say low evidence, that means that just a few research studies supported the use of that, whereas some of these had multiple research studies that supported the use of these strategies. But this whole thing was based on assessment data that showed results. So the results from different projects and from different research studies gave us this collection of evidence. Now, the other thing around assessment data, not the other thing, but one of the things, is that we want to see improvement from before intervention to after the intervention. So this is a set of studies here. This is by Diane Bryant and her research team. It's not a set of studies. This is one study. And this is the data in a school, school one, school two, and school three. And what I want to see is this is what the students were doing collectively before the intervention. And then once the intervention was implemented, you can see student scores increased. The same thing here, before intervention, and then during and after intervention. Before intervention, during and after intervention. And if I look at these scores, I can see that the students in those schools improved from before the intervention. So that tells me that there's an evidence base for what they were teaching. And this example here, this is also about assessment data. This is a collection of study. This one here is by Jennifer Krawick, and this is by Lynn Fuchs. But here I can see that I'm looking at improvement compared to from the intervention students to the non-intervention students. So in this study here, here are the students that received intervention. Here are the students that did not receive intervention. We see the gap widen quite a bit for the students that do not participate in the math intervention. Now, this graph here looks very, very statistically heavy. It's presenting effect sizes, but what we can see here is students who received a word problem intervention versus students in a control group, students who received a word problem intervention versus students in a number combination intervention. So we can actually look at these comparisons to see if there was improvement compared to students that did not receive treatment. And if I was looking at this graph, it would definitely be the word problem students versus the control and the number combination students versus the control. Now, another thing about evidence is, has this study been replicated? So here's an example of original study, and here's another example of another part of the original study. And then if I look here, that study has been replicated by multiple researchers. So the first study was done by Lynn Fuchs and her colleagues, and then this work was replicated by a group of different researchers. So in terms of replication, the evidence is stronger because multiple researchers have conducted work in this area. I also want to think in terms of replication, like, has this been done with multiple students? So if I look at this study here, there were 139 students that participated in intervention. That's a lot. And not only did they have students at third grade, we had students at fourth grade. This study here has four different students who participated in the intervention. If I just showed the performance of one student, that's okay. But by showing a second student and a third student and a fourth student and how students responded to the intervention, that's even better. And then has the study been conducted a multiple number of times? This is some research that comes from Lynn Fuchs and her colleagues at Vanderbilt. This is a problem-solving intervention, and they've done a lot of work in this area. At second grade, at third grade, they've done multiple year studies, so they've done it over a number of years. And I think they even have a first grade study that they're working on that shows that this problem-solving practice is a strong one. And then I also want you to think about, is the setting in students in the original research similar to your own? So, you know, we are working here in the United States. Probably most of you live in the United States. Some of you might be outside of the United States, but some of you might live in rural areas, maybe more suburban areas, or more even urban areas. So if research is conducted in an urban area, you've got to think, like, well, how well does that represent the students that are in my area? And the same thing when it comes to students. Are the demographic backgrounds or the socioeconomic backgrounds of the students in the original research, are those similar or at least kind of similar to the students that you will be working with in your setting? So I want you to take all this information and think about activity number 4. So you're going to locate different mathematics interventions, and I want you to rate the evidence. So that goes back to this idea of like thinking about the assessment data, thinking about the replication, and thinking about whether the setting and students are similar to your own. All right, so here we are. We're reviewing this part of Module 3. Remember, we're focused on this orange area here, which I really like to think about as the instructional platform. And ideally, we want to have evidence-based interventions. When those aren't available, we are going to rely on evidence-based strategies. And where do you find those? I would say you need to rely on journals or books or internet sites that have surveyed the evidence. And then when you're looking at that evidence, I want you to always think about whether there's assessment data that actually shows that the program or the strategy has intervention, whether it's been replicated several times, and whether it's going to be applicable to your setting and the students that you're working with. So the checklist for this part includes, the question was, where do you locate evidence-based practices? And by now, I hope you can identify sources for locating evidence-based practices and also determine the magnitude of that evidence. So we'll finish this part by having you do a journal entry. So I want you to reflect upon your own teaching and the things that you teach. What are the evidence-based practices that you use? And how do you know of their evidence base?